Any questions? Any questions on the wound blessing as we ended last week? And are there any questions, anything that possibly came to your mind or you thought about concerning the wound blessing? Any questions? As we turn the page and continue to move, remember, we have to get to a place where we embrace fear of opening old wounds. Understand that either way it's going to be painful. Either we isolate ourselves, that's pain, or if we discover the love of God and let his hands be on our wounds, that's still painful, but this pain will lead to healing. The other pain leads to isolation and death. But also, as we move on, not only do we embrace fear of opening old wounds, but we have to embrace the fear of judgment. Fear of judgment. When we talk about judgment, often there comes a time we have secret doubts about ourselves. Secret doubts about ourselves. The question is, why can't we simply be who God created us to be? Be who I am with no makeup. Why is it that you and I somehow have to have makeup when we address certain people or do certain things? Why can't we simply be who God created us to be? Y'all know as well as I know that there are certain places that you go and you got to act a certain way. And, you know, it's like we can act one way at home, but when we go to a certain place, maybe uptown or maybe out of town, it seems like we have to act a certain way. What is about us so wrong at home that we can't genuinely be ourselves at other places? That's the question I need us to really try to answer tonight. Are we that wrong at home that we have to change and be someone else at another location? Because I always wonder, why is it in certain circles I have to act a certain way around different people? But when I'm with certain people, I can act a certain way. And the stress is not on the different groups. The stress is on me because now I have to pull down a different shade of a mask to somehow make me feel like I'm included in the group. And I think we say that haphazardly. You know, when I'm in Rome, I like you in Rome. You know, we say that. But have we really critically thought out why we have to change who we are depending on the circles that we are in? Why can't we just be who we are without makeup? Why we have to have makeup on? Why we have to have a different mask on? I'm just opening this up to get us to think. Because are we that bad when we are free that we now have to cover what we, if you're so free in who you are, why you got to cover it up? Is that real freedom if you got to cover up when you out or you with certain people? I don't think that's freedom. I think that's bondage if you can't continue to be who you are when you feel like you're free. Am I making sense? And so just to open this up, be who I am with no makeup. I shouldn't have to make up myself to be accepted by other people. But oftentimes we do. We do. And it goes back, y'all, to this word called shame. You remember back in the Impact Conference, we talked about this a lot. The difference between guilt, what we do, and shame is who we are. And so if I'm ashamed of who I am, often it carries a heavier burden of what I do called guilt. Because in this shame process, I have to again have these different shades that I have to cover myself to help me somehow feel comfortable in the different groups that I am a part of. Someone quickly go to Genesis 3:10. I'm you know, we've been in Genesis a lot, and every time we read it, it seems like it's a new revelation. But I want you to listen carefully what Adam says. Carefully. There's a lot of theological ramification, but I just want a simple interpretation. I don't want you to be so deep, but I want you to have a simple interpretation when you read Genesis 3 and 10. What does it say? Man answered.
I heard you walking in the garden. Mm-hmm. And I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid.
I heard you walking in the garden. Here it is. And I was afraid. He was really saying, I was ashamed because I was naked. Here's the question. If you just read it simply, why was he ashamed of his nakedness when he had been naked all the time? He had sinned, yeah. It was about what he did, but what he did, what that had to do with him being naked. You feel? And we know all the theological ramification, but if we just read that for word to word, why would you all of a sudden ashamed? It wasn't that they never saw themselves naked, but at this point, because of disobeying what he did, he's now ashamed of who he is. Could it have been for the very first time he saw himself and he did not like what he saw? Could that be? Could that be the fact that he finally saw himself for who he really was, and he could not accept that, and for some odd reason he wanted to become someone differently instead of the person God created him to be?
Uh-huh. Time in our life, and then we realize that was not me.
Right.
I have to do better. I don't want to be
right.
That person.
Right. But I don't want to be that person. So here's the question. Well, why am I ashamed of who I am with all of my stuff? Because what?
You didn't like what you saw.
Now, is it that I didn't like what I saw, or I didn't like what I did? Yeah. But here's the problem with 3:10. He didn't say, I heard you, and because I ate from the tree, I hid myself. See, that's what he did. It's not because he took the fruit from Eve. He didn't say, listen now, he didn't say, oh, I ate that fruit that woman gave me, and that's why I hid myself. He didn't say that. So it was not guilt. He said, because I was naked. What was it about him that he didn't like? His eyes was open because of what he did. But what was it about him that he didn't like when he saw who he was before he ate? He just thought, listen, don't think they was blind and couldn't see it. They saw themselves naked. They just didn't understand the difference between good and evil. They didn't have the discernment of good and evil. What they acknowledged once they did it was, uh-oh, we messed up. That was guilt. But he never said, I heard you walking, and because I ate from the tree, I hid myself. Listen to it carefully. He says, because I was naked. All of a sudden, now his nakedness come into play when nakedness never had anything to do with it. It was all about do not eat from that tree. He the one brought up that he was naked. Then that's why God says, who told you was naked? In other words, why is it so bad that you're naked? I know you messed up, but why is it so bad of who you are? I made you. Why are you hiding what I made? Yes. Yeah. John 8. Yeah. And you're right, but he was talking about himself. You're right on. In other words, and you bring a good point, Brittany, because now it was like he was beating his own self up.
Yeah.
He was. But here's what I want us to get to the point. He was never beating himself up over his action. He was beating himself up over who he was. So I think so many times, y'all, we never get to the action. We stop at who we are. And that's why we may keep on doing what we do that's wrong, because we never get to the guilt. We stop at the shame. And that's why Adam couldn't fix the guilt. It took the second Adam to die, because he stopped at the shame. Who you are does determine what you do. Now, what you believe determines what you do, not who you are. Because I could be born, and see, that's the stereotype that we live in now in this world. I could be born in the hood, and because I'm born in the hood, I guess I'm supposed to be hoodish all my life. Right? Or if I'm in the country club, it means I'm supposed to be superior all my life. Or if I'm a black man and I got some money, does that mean I'm better than the other black man? But you bring up something very good, Joey, because I think a lot of people think, well, who I am determines what I do. And what God is saying, what you did doesn't determine who you are. And see, what we do, we succumb to what we do. We fall to something that's beneath us. That's why it's called the fall of man. And God says, get yourself back up. In fact, I would keep you from falling if you just hold on to me. But if you always focus on what you don't like about you, then I can't really heal your guilt until I heal you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right. That's right. That's right. That's right. 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 I'm going to throw something at you, London. Because you just hit something. You just hit something. Because if this is never healed, then this becomes my antidote to try to heal it.
That's right.
See, if I never heal of my shame, then my guilt never fades me. That's why I become a repeat offender, because that now becomes my medication. That becomes my makeup to keep me from really seeing who I am. That becomes my addiction. And I can never get to really erasing or getting past the shame. So that's why people hide behind the bottle. They hide behind something. Y'all feel me now? Y'all getting it now? Is it coming?
Cover up.
It's a makeup. So God's, again, notice now, he never said, I'm hiding because I ate the fruit. I'm hiding because I'm naked. It's like God says, where'd that come from? Who told you you're naked? What big deal? You been naked. I never put no clothes on you. And you've been, and we don't know between when they was created and chapter 3:10, how long it was. I don't think it was the next day, y'all. It was some time that they wrong. They had some time to think about this thing. So all this time, now all of a sudden, nakedness is a problem. They never acknowledged the guilt. Then he says, he never acknowledged, he blamed that woman you gave me. Yeah, that woman you gave me. So he still never acknowledged his guilt. You can never acknowledge your guilt until you understand your shame. Makeup. He was, but he refused to see it because of makeup. Brother Tim, you had your hand up? Yeah. Mm-hmm. 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 Yeah, and then instead of acknowledging that, he was looking at him. Now, in a couple words, and there's no right or wrong, no wrong answers, all are right. But in a couple words, I'm going to give you 1 minute. I want you to just describe yourself. In 1 minute, think about it. Go. Just write it down, think about it. Write it down, think about it. Process it in your mind. You got 1 minute. You got 50 seconds now. I want you to describe yourself. I want you to be honest, but describe yourself. And however you describe yourself, that's on you. There's nothing wrong with the way you see you. 30 seconds. 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, and one. Describe yourself. Anybody?
I put saved, connected to the Father, quick to confess, and seek Him for my need, ask Him for guidance, for restoration of
the need. Okay. Describe yourself. Go ahead. What else? Yes, sir.
Son.
Son. Okay. Describe yourself. Go ahead. Okay, good. Anybody else? Describe yourself. Okay, good. Describe yourself. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
I see myself as a passionate person.
Yeah.
Direct and truthful and will stick with my understanding.
Good, good. Yeah, stick with that gut. Yeah, I got you. Go ahead. That's good. What else? Okay. Good, 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 good. I love it. Go ahead. Okay, good, good. Willing, hospitality, yeah. What up? Yes, sir.
Three words: dedicated, determined, and demanding.
Good. That sounds like a sermon, Reverend. Yeah, what else? Amen. Amen. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, ma'am.
I said intelligent, love, beautiful, and I scratched out something that I know I can say victory.
Good, good, good. Yes, 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 yes.
I said something about hopeful, honest, curious, genuine, obedient, self-conscious, worry, wart, and consistent.
Okay, yep, all right, good, good, good. Right, right, come on, talk to me. Describe yourself. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Love and humble.
Love and humble? Go ahead. Is that all? Okay, cool. Mom.
As a person to be God,
I'm like nobody. Okay, you unique, aren't you? You are, you amen. So, anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Talk to me. Anyone else?
Okay, I have caring, loving, kind, forgiving,
good, good, good. Right, right, right. Go ahead. I love this. I love this. All this. I love this. Anybody else? Oh, I like the oxymoron there. Yeah. Yeah, slide it in. All right. Yeah. Right. Right. Okay. Good. 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 Anybody else? Joey? Yeah, Jenna?
Mm-hmm. And this is going to sound funny. Knowledgeable and wannabe warrior.
Wannabe warrior. Wannabe warrior. Okay. All right. What else? Good. All right. Now, is there anything about you that's defective? Yeah. Embarrassing. Anything about you that's not good enough? Now, y'all know it's a setup, didn't you? Because everything we said was and that's great, be positive about yourself. But nobody talked about the defective, embarrassing things. Why? Y'all, but listen, y'all thought about it. Y'all ain't gonna say it though, but you thought about it. No, direct can be very positive, cause we need some yes be yes and no's be no's and stop having some wishy washy folk. Yeah, I see that's positive. Now, if you just negative with your directness, that's. That's right. Now you're right, mother, because if you can be negative and being direct, you can. You can be negative and turn a fuck off. Yes, ma'am. I catch that. That is defective. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Get you in, yeah.
Yeah, can I point you out?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So you can call me Victory when, and I was like, that's not my name.
Right, right.
I thought I was in the court or something.
Oh, no. Victory is your name.
Yeah.
Because you have victory.
Yeah.
Yeah. You was good. Good. I'm glad we got that clarification. but at the same time, I think that exercise helps us to understand where we are. And we still got to acknowledge some things that makes us shame. Here. I hid because I was naked. Yeah. Yeah. You see? Yeah. Yeah. Right. That's right. You're right. And I'm going to make a connection to the cross in a minute. Go ahead. Oh yeah, you don't never go. This was just an exercise, just to prove a point. But no, there's some things. You know, there's some things you come out, but there's some deep things that you never share openly. You know, you'll make sure that you will say those things in private. And I really believe it's a part of growth, because you can have some folk in here that would give a testimony and tell you a lot of stuff, and we may be thinking, oh, that's too much information. But they may be at the point where I'm free. I have nothing to hide. And I think that's also okay. So I don't think that just because I didn't open up and tell you everything, I'm not going to say, oh, you got some spiritual growth to go. No, I think it's a process other than somebody else. They may be at that point where they're comfortable. And what this is teaching us is that we have to come out of the place where we don't have as much shame. And if we are asked directly, we don't have to stutter about it. But how do we get to that place? And that's what this is going to teach us. Yes.
And I think one thing with the defects, you have to be okay.
Yeah.
With the defects. Like, I can say what my defects are, and I'm not ashamed of them.
Mm-hmm.
Too many projects.
Mm-hmm.
And too blunt.
Mm-hmm.
That's my weakness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
There's no need to try to hide.
Right.
And then I'm juggling.
So you're not hiding to say I'm naked.
Right.
I got you. You're right, Reverend.
Knowing yourself and embracing.
It is. And understand the very thing that Adam was afraid of and ashamed of, and it took God to cover him. It was only in the second Adam that he was uncovered and died naked on the cross. Did y'all catch that? Second Jesus.
Okay.
Yeah, Jesus becomes the second Adam. Good question. That's what we're here for. The second Adam becomes Jesus Christ. Because the first Adam could not bring us to God. So the second Adam, Jesus Christ, now becomes what? The bridge between humanity and God. Good question. Yes, ma'am.
And then I can see my growth, because I was quick to confess and seek God for guidance, for restoration, and renewal.
Mm-hmm.
Because I can remember when I said it.
Yeah.
That was it.
Right.
Right. Because the Holy Spirit was not residing in me to quicken me to that point.
Right.
Hey, you know, you got to be helped.
Right. But watch this. Watch how the mood changed in the room just now. Look how, if I put on my psychologist hat, look how the mood changed. Because it was like, okay, describe yourself. It's like, okay, here I am. Even though it's in the back of my mind, yeah, these are here too. And then when it was like the ice was broken, it's like the mood was like, oh, okay, let me tell you. You know, and again, I think the more we have conversations and saying, it's not that I'm boasting in my shame, but it is a point of that I'm describing that I understand who I am without being ashamed. And who I am takes along with me my flaws, my scars, my wounds, all my imperfections. I cannot put them in a box and hide them and put a mask on and say, here I am.
Well, that won't help. That could, because
right.
You putting them in a box and hiding them.
Right.
Maybe prevent them, but if it's someone else.
Right. Right, because it brings life. And we're going to get to the scripture in a minute because it does that. Yes, ma'am.
When I realized that the shame I had,
yeah.
When I got over it, I didn't get over it until someone was saying, I won't go in detail, they said, I don't know how they did that.
Ah.
I said, I do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I do. Yeah. I want to be in myself.
Exactly.
And I think you had too.
So you acknowledge that. Right. And watch this. If, and we're going to talk about this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, if I'm hidden and my mind is hidden, then I would never see it. Y'all with me? But according to 2 Corinthians 4, the only ones mind that's veiled are unbelievers. And if we are a believer, we see things. Even though the things we see are also painful. Y'all with me?
Good.
Yes, sir. Let me go to Deacon first, and I'll come back to you, Ransom. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right. 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 No, we can't. Right. Our death becomes the life to somebody else. And we miss that. We always want to look alive. Because to live is Christ. Die is the gain. Right. 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 And of course, you don't get up every Sunday morning and say, I got a testimony, same testimony, tell me about the dirt. No, we don't do all that. Right. But at the appropriate time, I'm not ashamed. And I think it goes back to finding our core. Mr. Flo.
Because even in this that, until I learned to do that, it did not, I was still that, all that person. In
yeah,
life.
Yeah.
I was that mother.
Yeah.
I was that daughter.
Yeah.
I was that minister.
Yeah.
I was that teacher.
Yeah.
I was that employee.
Mm-hmm.
But all that was in there.
Yeah.
Even in the midst of some things happening, right. God began to show that. Even in the midst of that, did not change who I was.
That's right.
All was in one thing.
That's right. That's right. And it makes a difference. It makes a difference. Finding your core. I think so many times what happens is we missed our core. We miss our core. He uses a story here that talks about a guy who grew up not liking himself, and it was like he had a good side and he says a demon side. And the demon side kept on telling him how worthless he was. You know, have you seen that? You've seen those movies where you have the angel over here and the devil over here? And so it was like he was putting that portrayal, and he was always downing himself. He tried to be more, but after trying to be more and impress everybody else, he left the scene and was actually feeling empty. He did all this impressive stuff, but went back home and just is empty. And so he thought for a long time he was empty on the inside until he and his brother one day was out golfing. And he looked at the golf ball. He says, I wonder if this golf ball hollow inside. And what he did was him and his brother smashed the golf ball and found out there was a rubber band-like substance inside. So they kept on peeling the layers and peeling the layers and peeling the layers and peeling it. And finally got to the core and found out that the core was solid. And so from that day on, he says, you know what? Whenever I find my core, I understand that my core inside of me is solid, which means I'm worthwhile. I'm not empty. I'm not worthless. But we got to understand who our core is. Because if I never understand who my core is, I will always see myself as being empty. Go to 2 Corinthians. Let's do what's called an exegesis. Let's do an interpretation, or what's called hermeneutics, and begin to look at this, and I'm going to look at it from a Greek translation as well. And if you go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1, I want to do that, read actually 1 through 12, and I want us to really begin to dissect these words and exegete this text. Are you there? It says, therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, Now, in the English, it says mercy of God, but actually in the Greek, it is actually one word, one word, one word. Everybody say, elithymion, elithymion. That is mercy of God. And what it does, it not only is compassion, but what it does also, it shows that we have been set free from slavery. And so he says, therefore, having this ministry, here it is, by being set free, we do not lose heart, which means we do not become discouraged. How in the world can we become discouraged when God has set us free, but on top of that, given us a service? He said, I didn't just set you free to just let you roam free, but I've given you something to do to bring glory to me. So I set you free from what you didn't deserve to be set free from in the first place. But because I did, I give you now a ministry. And you, even though you may go through a depressing or discouragement moment, you don't succumb to it. Look at verse 2. We have renounced disgraceful, here it is, underhanded ways. The underhanded ways is a Greek word that means things hidden because of shame. Things hidden because of shame. Things hidden because of shame. Things hidden, here it is, because of what? Shame. So we have renounced disgraceful things hidden because of shame. What's shame? Who we are. Why have we renounced that? Because he has set us free and given us an opportunity to do what? Ministry. So we don't, no longer are we succumbing to discouragement, but also we renounce disgraceful, underhanded ways. Here it is. We refuse to practice, which means we refuse to walk in what? Cunning or to tamper with God's word. So cunning means I don't have to be a con man anymore. I don't have to just say things that I think will tickle your ears or what you want me to say. Y'all with me? How many times have we said things because we was afraid to talk direct? And so what we have done now, we went to the MAC store or whatever makeup store you go to, ladies. We have went to those stores, and even men, we went to our spiritual makeup store. And if you notice what they do, they'll try. I've walked through South Park and looked at the MAC place, and what they do is they're trying to find your skin complexion. They put dots on you. They put dots trying to match up your skin complexion. And they have so many dots. Now, once they find it, they erase those dots and put the right complexion on you, right? But what I've discovered is that we got so many shades on us. Look a mess. But I know the right shade to use at the right moment for the right person. So I got a shade for you. 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 And by the time I use all them shades, I'm worn out. That's right. Because of shame. I'm hiding because I don't want you to know who I am. So he says, we don't walk in the con man. We're not cunning anymore. We don't temper with God's word. If we're going to be true with God's word, we ain't going to go with God's word and then go with something else. But by, here it is, the manifestation, the open statement of the truth, the manifestation, here it is, we would commend ourselves to every man's, here it is, conscience. That is what? That's everybody say, suvitissim. That means good or bad. That's conscience. That's conscience. That's conscience. So that's discernment of good or bad. So here it is. Listen to what it says. He says, we would commend ourselves. It's only when it's manifestation. It's only when we're walking in truth that we now commend ourselves to every man's conscience. Which means, Dennis, I commend myself to what you think about me. I ain't studying you. Y'all with me? That's what the text says. We commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Which means, if you don't think I'm worthy, I'm not going to pour this shade down to make you like me. If you don't like, if you ain't gonna talk to me, I ain't gonna pull the shade down to make you talk to me. Y'all with me? If you don't think I should be doing what I'm doing, I'm not gonna pull the shade down to get your brownie points.
All right.
But it's only, here it is, when we don't practice trying to comfort, when we don't temper with God's word, when we take the God word as the only thing that we rely on, but by the open statement of truth, we commend ourselves, we give ourselves. We ain't gonna change ourselves based on what people think about us. Mm-hmm. And so many times we've been pouring down shade, we're worn out. And what happened is it wasn't the folk, it was the shades we had. They made me sick. It wasn't them. It was you was trying to change yourself to fit in their world. Amen. You was changing yourself trying to fit in their fantasy of you. Right. You was changing yourself to try to fit in their reality when they did not even create you. Verse 3. And even if our gospel is veiled, hidden. Watch this. It is veiled only to those who are perishing. Y'all got me? Look at verse 4. In their case, the God, lowercase g, of this world, here it is, has blinded their minds of the unbelievers. Whose minds are blinded?
The unbeliever, right?
So he didn't say if you come to church every Sunday. He didn't say if you're in Bible study every Wednesday. He didn't say if you look like you saved. He said that the way to determine if you're a believer or unbeliever is because if your mind is blinded, if your mind is veiled. Check this out. Even if our gospel is veiled, why did Jesus have to come and the first Adam couldn't reverse the curse? Because he hid himself. God made him, but he didn't believe it. Did y'all catch this? It is veiled only to those who are perishing. Look at verse 4. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them, here it is, from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the likeness of God. For what we preach is not ourselves. Why are you getting upset with people and with life when this thing is not about you? Why are you getting frustrated with life when it's not about you? Of course you got to make some difficult decisions. Of course you got to have some strong minds when it comes to stuff. I ain't telling you just be a wimp and wallow and let people walk over you. No. But I'm saying there's certain things you shouldn't concern yourself about. There's certain things you shouldn't panic about. There's some things you should not waste sleep over. Because the good news is about Jesus the Christ. With ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. Look at verse 6. For it is the God who said, let light shine out of what?
Darkness.
Out of darkness. Who has shown in our hearts the light of knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. Did y'all catch this? In the face of Christ. In the face of, if I say face of Christ, what does that mean? It means I don't identify with you until I see your face. You see, I may know you but can't call your name. God, I know you. What's your name? What is your name? I know your face, Lord. What is your name? I identify. Only the believers identify with the face of God, but unbelievers can't identify because their minds are blinded. You got it? And what keeps us blinded is when we're hidden because we're embarrassed of who we are, even with our shame. Now, here it is. Check this out. But we have this treasure. Everybody say, thesaurus. Thesaurus, which means deposit. Thesaurus, which means deposit. But we have this thesaurus, this deposit, this treasure. The reason why we ain't sweating this, the reason why we're not afraid to show our wounds and our scars, because we have something that's solid inside of us. We have a thesaurus, a treasure, a, a deposit, here it is, in earthen vessels. Earthen in the Greek means clay. Vessels simply means jars. So he says, you have something of great value in clay. Why would you put something of great value in something that could not protect it? Have you ever felt clay? You ever felt clay? Uh-huh. Watch this. Watch it. And it's to show that the transcendent power belongs to God and not us. The reason why I put something valuable into something that could not hold it was not to show you, but to show the power that's in you. You are not worthless, but you're worthwhile because you're solid inside if you have Jesus. So then he says, watch this. We are afflicted, which means you're going to go through affliction. You're going to go through some times it's going to stretch you. But one thing about clay, only thing clay when it stretches, it just expands. Watch this. You are afflicted in every way, but not what? Why are you not crushed? Because if you put clay down and try to mash it, all it does is just, again, expands. The reason why you're still here, because you are expanded. And you was praying, Lord, enlarge my territory. Didn't know that you had to be pressed in order to be expanded. Okay, y'all going to sleep. This is good to me. Watch this. Watch this. He says, you are what? You are perplexed. Which means you have those moments where you become depressed. You're stressed. You don't know. If you had it in the hair, you'll pull it out. But watch this. It does not drive you to despair. You ain't locked up and the key thrown away. That's right. No. You had a moment where you was almost there. Oh, God. You almost there. You was about to take somebody else there with you. But thanks be to God because of the core that was solid. Even though the clay was at times picked apart. And when God put you back together, he don't need no super glue. All he needs is his hand. Y'all with me? Because we don't always want to act right on that wheel. Sometimes we want to get out of focus. And God, one thing about it, I think one sermon a couple years ago, I always say, no matter what the clay is, God's hand is always in it. He know how to bring us back in and shape us. Watch this. He says, we are persecuted. And everybody's persecution is different. You may not have to go get killed by the gospel, but you're persecuted. Sometimes everybody don't understand your persecution, but you're persecuted, but not what? Forsaken, which means you're not left alone. You are struck down, but what? Not destroyed. Now here it is. Why not? Here it is. Verse 10. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus. So that the life of Jesus, here it is, may be manifested in our bodies. Here it is, verse 11. For while we live, we are always what? Being given up to the death of Jesus' sake. Which means, sake is in the Greek, dia. Everybody say dia. Dia Jesus, which means it's through Jesus. So you're not carrying death because you did it. You are carrying death or the body of Christ because he died. When he died 2,000 years ago, we all died with him. Again, like I always said, he don't come down every resurrection season and do this thing over again. But at one moment, what did he do? He died. And when he died, guess what? We now have something that's more powerful in us.
All right.
Y'all with me?
Yes, sir.
And the power is that he died. That's why you never forsake the cross. Watch this. For while we live, we are always being given up to death through Christ. So that the life of Jesus may be what? Revealed in our mortal flesh. Now you know what Paul meant when he says to live is and to die is. Now verse 12 is what you need to understand. So death is at work in us, But life in whom? There's some things that your clay, your dust, is being pressed and stretched, and it has nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with somebody who's on the verge of dying without Christ but needs life. So every day you've been put to death, not always for you, but for somebody else. Why would you need to be put to death again if you already resurrected? If you already believe him. So there's a lot of things that we are going through that has nothing to do for us. But if we are ashamed to show what God has done, how can anybody say, my God, my Lord, when they see the holes that you have? There's a Thomas out there that needs to see and touch what Jesus has healed in your life. Are y'all listening? So, but we will hide our imperfections. We'll be ashamed of what we went through. Lord, I ain't want nobody to know. We get all them makeup artists, pour down them shades. But there's some people who wants to know your story and what the Lord has done for you. And if you are carrying his body, then he ought to be manifested through your mortal body. No longer is it I, but it's you who is what? In me. I need people to see Christ in me. Y'all with me?
Pastor,
yes, ma'am.
We not say we're like a downfall in the spiritual life on the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
There are several different clubs that you have to hit a certain thing with.
Mm-hmm.
God don't hit us with the same club mm-hmm. all
the time. Right,
right. And whoever that club comes to are in the hand of the hitter.
Right.
Because he's a coin in our life.
Right, right.
And we are wrapped.
Right. You ain't never seen a golf ball explode.
No.
Unless there was something that really was dysfunctional. But those major golfers, they hit that thing so hard, pow. And no matter how hard they hit it, it's still there. It's still there. It'll roll in, it'll bounce. It can go in the water, come back out, still dry. I mean, wherever it goes, wherever it's hit. Right? And one thing about most golf balls that they play on the PGA course is never yellow, it's never pink, it's never red. Now, you go play putt-putt, that's not real stuff. It's always white. So whatever hazard is in, it's always discoverable. Okay, y'all missed that. Because you got to understand, it's about being purified. It's about being washed in the blood. So whatever hazard situation you are in, God can always discover you. He don't discover you from without because he's already within. That's right. That's right. That's right. And that's sometimes you bounce. Yeah. And that's sometimes you hit, then you'll spin and come back. Sometimes you'll miss the mark, but God will know how to spin you back and bring you back to the hole.
Put you back on the
team. Oh, God. Lord have mercy. But we cannot get to a place where our secret doubts causes us to have shame or not to acknowledge those things that we are ashamed of. Know that you have a solid core, and because of your marks or your imperfections, you're still worthwhile. Yes. What you have been through does not make you worthless.
It doesn't.
Because you have a treasure, a deposit. Yes, sir.
I got stuck on verse number 2.
Yes.
Where it says renounce.
Uh-huh.
And the word renounce means to reject or mm-hmm. abandon or mm-hmm. shun.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point in our life, we got to be able to shun that what it is that shames us.
Yep.
You know, we sing that song, Break Every Chain.
Break Every Chain.
But you see, the chain doesn't have no power over us.
Right.
Take the chain out, and that's right. What it means to renounce.
Right, right.
So to renounce means we disown
right.
this shame. We put it off.
Right, right,
and
right. That's good.
That's the answer.
That's good.
To get rid of that shame.
We renounce disgraceful things.
Deny, reject.
That's hidden because of shame. That's it.
Disown it.
You disown it. In other words, I may have the scar, but it doesn't validate who I am. What it's done is allowed me to get through this season. And maybe that's the reason why God has so many scars on us. Because we need so many reminders of what he's already done and what he can yet still do. Amen?
And I like this one too.
Yes, sir.
Wash one's hands of
it. No. Yeah.
Wash your hands of your shame.
Mm-hmm. That's it. That's it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for tonight. We're going to pause right here. And we thank you that you're still leading us. Even when we look at this fear of judgment, help us, God, to actually be who you created us to be and to be who we are already without any makeup. It's a process, God. But I pray that every lesson, every step we take through the Word of God, that you would help us to understand it's not about the exterior, but it's about the core. And you have put this core in fragile clay jars. Really, it's basically dust. And God, it's all about what you're doing from within. And I pray, Lord, that we would embrace this. As we move into next week, we're going to understand our need for validation, why we need to be validated. But we cannot look at the wrong sources for validation. So we thank you, God, for teaching us tonight. I pray, Lord, that someone was touched, someone was freed, and someone released those masks and be who you have called and